Hi, I hope you can hear me. Just to correct you in one thing, my car is only remotely controlled toy car, so small difference. Okay, welcome you to the presentation entitled Machine Learning and Image Processing, Not Only in Autonomous Vehicles. And I'm just curious, how many of you just came here only to hear about autonomous vehicles? What if I told you that there won't be anything about them? Probably some of you will leave the room, but okay, it's no problem. In fact, there will be something, maybe not too much. Maybe something about me. As Lukasz said, I work in Nokia in LTE control plane as a software engineer and also code reviewer. Some people would say that I waste my time as a Scrum Master, but I find this role quite useful for me. But I do waste my leisure time on surfing the internet and searching the information about technical novelties, artificial intelligence, and if I can find something that interests me, I publish the information on my blog. If I cannot find anything interesting, I practice archery. And autonomous cars. Do you know that people are really terrible drivers? Drunk driving, some recklessness. There are many factors that influence on our way of driving, and probably many of you have driven the car when you were tired. Is it right? How many of you? Okay, most of the people. I will not be asking about drunk driving. And what if we replace the human with a machine? You know, machines are deterministic. They are not tired. They do not drink, but they may take some drugs. I will tell you at the end of my presentation something about them. And what do you think when you hear autonomous cars? Because I have this in front of my eyes. Kit was really a unique car, and I'm still waiting when there will be something like that available. But probably a few decades needs to pass, and we will have something similar, I hope. But for today, what do we have? Probably most of you know Google car. Yep. A small vehicle that looks funny for someone. And the project started in 2009, and these cars have drove over 1.2 million miles autonomously. They were first tested in highways and then in traffic, in city traffic, and gathered a lot of data. They have learned a lot, and probably right now Google cars are the most experienced cars. They have some characteristic thing on the top. It's called LiDAR. It's a kind of laser scanner which maps the environment around the car and provides this information to all the computers in that car that make the decision based on that. And another example of autonomous car is the company Delphi and their Audi SQ5. It's doesn't have that sensor on the top, LiDAR, but it has it hidden just here and also on the back of the car. They claim that their car traveled over 5,000 miles autonomously, almost whole road. And they have also some visualization system in the dashboard that you can just instantly see what the car sees. Google car has the same, but you need to have your own laptop connected to the car to see such an information. And something futuristic, Mercedes claimed that they want to build their own autonomous car, Mercedes-Benz F015. It was presented in Las Vegas in Consumer Electronics Shows this year, and it looks really futuristic. It doesn't resemble today's cars. Even the interior is quite different, but it's only a prototype, and I think at least one decade will pass when we see this car on the road. Also, automation is visible in trucks. Scania is working on a technique called platooning, where only one driver drives the whole convoy of trucks. He sits in the front truck and all the rest of them is following the preceding ones. And these trucks just autonomously make decisions on the distance between the following truck. If they detect some overtaking, they make more space for the cars just to hide between them. And in another cases, they just want to save fuel, lower gas emissions. And all these cars work because of the sensors. We, as a human, we have some kind of sensors like eyes, ears, and the car also needs sensors to know what is just around it. And there are a few kinds of sensors. There are some short-range radars, like here, for, let's say, park assist. They usually use ultrasonic waves. And there are also cameras, usually for some traffic lights recognitions, the traffic signs and traffic lights recognition, a late departure warning. Also, they provide us a view from our rear mirror or side mirrors. And then we have some long-range radar, which helps to detect and avoid collisions. Now there are commonly advertised systems of the cars that brakes automatically when they detect an obstacles in front of them. And it all goes in the right direction. We have many systems like adaptive cruise control that we can also adjust the distance between the cars in front of us. But the most important from Google Car is the LiDAR. It just maps the environment around the car, as I told you, and it provides an image like this. The laser beam is sent from that sensor, just like I'm just sending the laser beam here, and it deflects and goes back to the sensor. And based on the time of going this wave, it can tell you what is the distance between our car and obstacle. And you have image like this, which is just cloud of some points. And I will tell you later about image processing, how such image is processed. But you need to know it's not easy to recognize what kind of obstacles there are, and if they are cars, pedestrians, or what, and how to behave properly in case of detecting any of them. And also there are many problems. First, legal problems with these cars. For now, the car cannot drive on its own. There always must be a driver that can take over the control in case of emergency. So we need to solve this. It will need to be solved. What in case of responsibility? You know, who is guilty when such a car just caused an accident? The programmer, maybe the manufacturer, or passengers, we still don't know. There are also many other errors. What if the reboot will be required when we just driving on the highway? Well, you should don't worry. You can always try hitchhiking, but please don't forget the towel. If you don't know what I'm talking about, just read the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. How it all works? First, we need to gather our data from the sensors, and then we apply some image processing techniques on them, and then they are an input to our machine learning systems. Optional phase is post-processing, when we can visualize the data or store them for, I don't know, further recognition or something like that. Okay, so image processing. There are a few techniques. Let's start with preprocessing. Preprocessing is usually used just to enhance image to allow better feature extraction. And it's not always necessary to apply some kind of these algorithms. You can just feed the raw image to our image machine learning algorithms, but usually it's better when you preprocess them and you can easily extract something from them. For example, the main issue is just resolution of that images. Do we really need 20 megapixels cameras to just make some photo of the road and then process it for, I don't know, 1 second? No, we need to make a decision quickly. So images needs to be resized. We also don't usually want colors. Do you think that colors are really useful? I mean, if the car in front of us is red or green? Or do we need colors to recognize traffic lights? What do you think?
No.
Why? Why not? Yes, exactly. The red light is always on top.
Or sometimes on the side.
Okay.
Some white and yellow road sign.
Stripes on the road.
Okay. It depends. I told that it doesn't need to be preprocessed, let's say in that way. So sometimes the color may be useful, but sometimes not. But usually we convert images to grayscale or binarize them just for fasten the processing. And there are also operations as blur or sharpening, but let's go with binarization. It's very easy to binarize image, but it's very hard to choose the proper threshold. These are images from my master thesis, which Lukasz was talking about. I recognized the forgery in the documents. So simply I had some document written with different pens, and my task was to tell if they were written with the same pen or not. If is it possible to distinguish between pens used to write the document. And first major problem that I faced was the threshold of binarization. So usually images are not uniformly enlightened. So the light is not uniformly distributed, and the middle of the image is lighter than the top or a bottom. So if you choose the wrong threshold, then you may have an image like this or like this. I wanted here to have all the pixels of pen marked in black. So this was the closest to the true. Also, there are some pixels that are not an ink, but always there is some classification error. And what about blur? I put this slide here for purpose, just to check how good the projector is. Can you see the difference here? There is an original image. It's the same image after applying blur operation and the same image after applying sharpening operation. There is always something called digital noise. And if you will apply, let's say, edge detector on raw image or sharpened image, it will provide you more false edges. So you want to preprocess it with blur operation, and it will allow you just to see only the proper edges. Okay, this is one of the really hopeless examples I have seen. I built my own neural network to recognize traffic signs. We are human, so we can easily recognize what kind of sign is it. But can computer do it? I tried everything. Nothing. This is also another kind of problems which we can face when building our systems that recognize signs. Okay, The next thing is segmentation. When we have recognized our pixels properly, which are the object, we need to find which are just one blob. For example, when we have people, when we have the image from LiDAR, just cloud of points, we need to know which are single object, like car, biker, pedestrian. The same here. Each color represents a different letter. So it's just, segmentation is just grouping. And the same for LiDAR, just as I said you. Different color means a different object. And you can just after that operation see that you have how many objects are there in the scene. And there are some algorithms for it, like edge detection, watershed method, or histogram biased method. I will not be talking about them. I used the first two. I have not been trying the third one. I can tell you that watershed method is quite quite interesting. When you imagine your image as a surface, and each value of the pixel is on z-axis, then zero means that you are low down, and big values like white parts of the pixel are very high. Then you have something like topographic map of an image. You have valleys and hills, and if there is a heavy rainfall, it falls onto that image, the water level rise. You can just check on which parts the water from different compartment, let's say, just start to meet. And it can somehow detect edges, or like edge detection algorithm, but it works slightly different. Also very important is object tracking. Once we detected the object, it needs to be tracked. We need to know if the car is approaching us, or the pedestrian is crossing in front of our bonnet, or what. And very good algorithm is SLAM. I got to know this quite recently, but from what I know, it allows the best object tracking, and I'm trying to implement it in my own toy car, but still no success. So something more clear, math. Some of you are sleeping, so you have an exercise. What is it? Maybe these matrices, anyone can tell me? Yes, exactly, it's Sobel. I'm not going to talk about this, because this is your reaction. But the math is very important in all the image processing. And if you do not have any solid math fundamentals, then you can try with these algorithms, but you will not understand how to choose, let's say, proper threshold with binarization, or how to properly apply edge detection. But you need to know one operation is very important, convolution. How many of you know convolution? Okay, at least half of the audience. So if you know the convolution, then probably almost every operation on images can be just like matrix multiplication. So it's quite easy. And also convolutional neural networks works in that way, which are widely used for recognizing images. And also there are a few problems with image processing. The first one I mentioned, big image resolutions. It means that there are many features and the images are longer processed, so the algorithms are more complex. Also, there is a problem with mapping three-dimensional environment to two-dimensional image. And digital noise is another kind of problems. The blur operation can fix it, but not always as good as we want. And one important thing, we really need to do this all in, let's call, real time. It needs to be done very quickly. And the images are then processed into some machine learning algorithms. And these algorithms, well, first, What is a conventional algorithm? Conventional algorithm has some logic which the developer puts into it, and it has some branches, loops, etc. So you have a simple simply task, just to recognize the intention of turning the car left or right, or maybe recognize the intention, recognize if something is trying to be on your way. Probably you would think about something like this. First, you need to recognize the cars. Then you need to find its blinkers, check if they are blinking. If so, then apply the possible route of this car on your environment map and check if there are any collisions. So let's check it. Here you have a simple scenery. Well, we can recognize the cars in teal frames and also some obstacles in green frames. We can also recognize the blinking blinker here. So our car is approaching slowly to that car and we see this blinker. So the decision should be just to slow down, to let him go. So we are slowing down, but we are approaching, coming closer and closer, and we see that the car is still staying on the shoulder lane. And when we are close enough, probably we will see that this rubbish just covered the right blinker, which also was blinking. So we missed something, yeah, because this car has hazard lights enabled and it's not going anywhere. Maybe we need to take into consideration this triangle staying here. There are so many cases that it's really very hard to implement them all. You can imagine unit test, how many will you need to write. And also there are situations that probably some of you have seen on the road, that left blinkers is blinking, but the car is actually turning right. I have seen such a situation not once. So the conclusion is that human as drivers are unpredictable, and we cannot predict every situation that they can cause. But we can do something quite different. Here we have our machine learning algorithms, and machine learning is just to not think about the algorithm, just make some, let's say, neural network and give it some examples from real life, and this network will need to think about it, how to solve it on its own. You can just only tell it if it solved the problem properly or not. And this is called supervised learning. You can also not tell if it resolved the problem right or not. So it's called unsupervised learning, and it's mainly used for some grouping or classification. It can just classify the same problems then. Okay, and I will talk about two algorithms: neural networks and SVMs, support vector machines. Neural networks are built just to be very similar to our human brains. We have neurons in our brains and they are connected somehow. And in artificial neural networks, we also have some neurons. They are usually called nodes. And each neuron in each layer is connected to every neuron in adjacent layers. And we have the first layer is called input layer. Then we can have multiple hidden nodes, and at the end is output node. This is just basic topology of neural network. But let me first talk about SVMs. Support vector machines are the algorithms that can solve binary problem. Binary, I mean that in the output we have the simple answer yes or no, or just classification, one group or another. Here you have sample images from LiDAR. Can you recognize any shapes here? What is it? Yes, these are cars. From different angles, no, because you can see cars from just like you see them on the road. And you have another set of examples, pedestrians. For you, it's quite obvious. You can even see in this form of cloud of points what is it. But think about two features that allows you to distinguish between cars and people. Okay, there are many answers. Speed, size. Okay, let's take one feature as a number of points. Cars are usually bigger, so they consist of a greater number of points. People are smaller, so they should have less points. Well, we can also take a speed as a, another feature. So people usually walk slower than cars, but it's not always true. And if we have a two-dimensional plot, we can put each of these objects onto our plot. So let's say that we have a size here, so the number of pixels, let's say, of points, and the speed here on y-axis. Cars are bigger and faster, yes, so they will be here. People are smaller and slower, so they will be here. And take a look at the data. They are normalized. Normalization is needed, for example, when we have different units. When we provide speed in kilometers per hour or miles per hour, we don't want to fix them. We just want to normalize the data. And also about the sizes, we don't want to generalize. We want to generalize because if something is closer, it will consist of a bigger number of points. If something is more distant, then it will have less pixels. And you can easily classify items here just by drawing a straight line. So this is our classificator. And it tells that everything above that line is a car and everything below that line is a pedestrian. But you can also draw a line like this or this. You can, in fact, have many lines. And which one is the proper? It's very important, because if you have a new set, let's say new sample, like here, so it is very fast, but consists of not so many points, maybe a biker, then if you choose this classifier, it will be classified as a car. But if you choose this one, then it will be classified as a pedestrian. And SVM just allows you to choose the optimal classifier. Its role is to maximize the boundaries and choose the one proper line that fits here and have the margins as big as possible. Of course, it's not always so easy, because you have some, you may have some outliers, or some cars may be here, or some pedestrians may be here. What SVM do, it doesn't usually use the linear classification, so it doesn't have to be straight line, or the problem can be transferred into a three-dimensional space then, if we have two dimensions. So it's just transform the problem to the n plus one dimensions. I will not go into mathematical theory behind this, but I'm going to talk more about neural networks now, and especially deep neural networks, because probably all of you know what neural network is, and how many of you have heard about deep neural networks? Okay, there are some people. Deep neural networks, there isn't any definition of this, but let's assume that it has more than 10 hidden layers. And deep neural networks used by Google, let's say, have something in common, the shape. Here you have an hourglass shape. Do you know why usually such a huge neural networks have hourglass shape? Yes, that's one of the explanation. If you have the problem like this, you have some digit recognition, and here are some pixels missing from the image. You want to achieve something like that. This problem can be called reconstruction, because here we don't have every data, and we want to reconstruct the data missing here. Usually you don't need every pixel let's say, of this image, every pixel doesn't provide you any particular information. From example, this part of this image, it doesn't have any information for you. But choosing the layers like this, if you have input layer, so the data goes from bottom to the up, and each next layer have less number of neurons. Why? Yes, there was a...
Some features in smaller set of variables.
Yes, it depends how do you look on this problem. Because there are convolution neural networks designed exactly to recognize images, but assume this is a casual network, and less number of neurons means that we are generalizing the information. So we don't need all the information provided here. We want to select only the meaningful information. So we are doing it many times, here, then here, then here. So we can say that we are compressing the data. But there is only some meaningful data. And there is a very funny fact, because the neural network can be just cut here, and here you have the output. You know just here what is the answer. So if it's a 5 or 0 or 3. And if you have only two neurons here, or three, you can project the highly dimensional problem to two or three dimensional problem. And you can see in two dimensions or in three dimensions, so it means that you can visualize the problem. This is an example of my master thesis where I was recognizing pens, and when I just made a scatter plot of the data, it looked like this. So I could easily see that the pen C is quite different from pen B. I can just see the data, but the pens D and E are not so easily distinguishable. Okay, we can finish our recognizing here, but here we are doing something more. We are reconstructing the data. So from this essential information, we want to reconstruct the images here. But in fact, we don't have to do exactly this kind of things. Take into consideration just simple image of cat. There are many images of cats, let's say white cat, black cat, red cat, cat upside down from the left, from the right. And you only need to recognize that it's a cat. So you probably don't need all the information that the image contains. So that's why you have a shape like this. And on this stage, you know that it's a cat. But then you can do something different. Let's say when your neural network recognizes it's a cat, it can meow. So it can convert image into voice or some kind of noise. Here, this neural network is converting image into words. But you can just design it as you want. You can have many kinds of features extracted and then converted into another type of data. So the application is very big. There are many areas in which deep neural networks are used, and most of the examples come from Google. Probably you have Android telephones, and you use Google Plus photo search, or you have ever tried to find similar images on the Google website. So that's all is based on Google's neural networks. And of course, there are some problems with such an algorithms, especially neural networks can be overtrained. Overtraining means that the network is not able to generalize properly. So it's like a student who comes to the exam. He has the set of questions just before the exam, and learn by heart every example. When the questions are similar, he can perform perfectly. But if something is different and he will not be able to draw any conclusions, he may fail. It's the same with neural networks. That's why they are similar to our human brains. About outliers, there is a good example. What is outlier? For example, for PenC, if we will have any point like here, which is blue, so it's for PenC, this is an outlier. So it's just form the one group. We don't want outliers because when we normalize our data or calculate average, etc., it just moves in a direction we don't want. We don't want the data to be very condensed, and it allows us to better recognize them. Neural networks are also very complicated mathematically, and they are black boxes. It means that you cannot easily tell what happened, just that this image was classified as a cat. You cannot look inside its network. You can just look on the nodes and edges, tell what were the weights, but it tells you nothing. So these are considered as black boxes. And if you attended today's presentation made by Filip Wójcik about machine learning, he told that in banking, people don't like neural networks because they need to have an explanation for every decision that has been made. So they usually use decision trees. Okay, a few things about tools. I'm a C++ guy, but I also use Python, and I started neural networks with MATLAB and Octave, and I was looking for anything interesting in C++, and I can tell you that I couldn't find any good library. But sorry? Yes, there are libraries, but it was a few years ago. And quite recently, I discovered that there are some good libraries. The first one, especially, dlib. It contains many machine learning algorithms, but image processing as well. Also, I didn't know that Open Computer Vision library has not only image processing algorithms, but also some machine learning techniques as well. And Boost itself has something called GIL. It's Generic Image Library. And you can also use it as to process your images. And just very quickly to show you the example of basic neural network in dlib. You create a simple network that has two input nodes, five hidden nodes, and one output node. It's the default parameter here. So training these neural networks is very easily. You want to train them on two-dimensional data. Just chosen randomly from -100 to 100. And if the distance between the center is less than 50, you want to classify pixel as 1. If the distance, otherwise you want to classify as 0. So just classify data into groups. And then after that you can check if your network was properly learned and how does it classify another examples. Only 13 lines of code for simple neural network. Okay, this is the problem that actually it solves. So data from -100 to 100 on both axes, and if the distance is less than 50, it is classified as 1, as a different group. Also an example of object tracking, very quickly. When you have the data from your camera, probably some of you know that it comes as a sequence of images. So here we can just mock it with reading files from directory. We have set of images. We are loading them into a vector, then we sort them. And we take the first image, the initial frame, and we create some tracker. and we tell him to track the rectangle that has the center here with some width and height. And then in the loop, we are just calling update on the next images. It's a basic code for simple image tracker. I don't have any images for this, so only sample code. Okay, so just to sum it up, image processing and machine learning algorithms are widely used, especially for autonomous cars. Things that I have talked about was sign recognition, traffic lights recognition, also obstacles recognition. We also want to check if the objects in the road are pedestrians, bikers, cars, so we need to distinguish between them and predict the behavior of that object. They are used to avoid collisions and decide on lane changing, bypassing, overtaking, etc. Question for you. Who of you have seen this image before? Okay, there are a few people, so be quiet. Those who don't, who have not seen, can you tell me what is it? I will.
Painting made by some network of neutrons?
To be precise, it's a Google's neural network. Maybe let's start with the program called Deep Dream. It was open sourced this year, I think, and it allows to visualize how the neural networks find the patterns on the image. So Google's neural network was provided an image of random noise. So there was completely nothing on that image, and this neural network recognized such patterns on them. It was learned to recognize landscapes, so you can see some icebergs, fountains, so buildings, I don't know. And it created such an image, really inception, isn't it?
This is a nice example of overfitting.
Exactly. And did you know that we cannot dream about faces that we have not seen? Probably every face in our dream we have seen at least once, maybe in television, I don't know. But the same is for neural network. It cannot find pattern that it do not know before. So it was trained on the patterns like this, and then it can find them on just random images. Another question for you. How many animals are in this picture?
Thousands.
Thousands. Who can see at least one?
An animal.
Well, I cannot see any, but Google Neural Network can see plenty of them. And not only animals, also some buildings and vehicles as well. So this is how it works. I don't know what kind of drugs does it take, but it should take only half. Okay, so these are the resources for images that I used. And if I can recommend you something what is worth reading or watching, the first is the presentation of how a driverless car sees the road. It's from the Google car. It's a TED talk, about 1 hour. You can see their animations, how the Google recognize object on the road. So I recommend it to you. But if you more prefer to learn something about machine learning, then just attend this Coursera course led by Dr. Andrew. And if you are particularly interested in deep neural networks, this presentation is for you. It's by Jeff Dean from Google. Okay, that's all. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We still have 10 minutes for questions, if there are any, so please raise your hands. Okay, I can see already hands. This gentleman was the first one.
So,
Sorry to disagree, but I don't like the part about neural network being similar to human brain. It was a popular misconception in 50s, but I think, I'm not sure if you agree with me, but for a few years now, I think we know that it's completely unlike human brain. We only suspect that spiking neural networks might be similar, but they're not. Not sure, could you comment on that?
Well, it depends on many things, but as you know, there are many kinds of neural networks, and some of them may behave quite similar to our brain, some of them may not. For example, convolution neural networks, where the nodes in layers are not connected to every other nodes in adjacent layers. And this is example of image recognition. Probably when you enter this link, you will find something about how particular image recognition works and how the neural networks, convolutional neural networks, just do their job. Because if you know how the convolution works, you will see that there are many image is processed by many networks and is divided to many pieces, because usually you don't want to associate, let's say, the human on the picture with the building that is on there. So image can be cut, and in some ways it works exactly as human brain, because you can easily see that this is an Eiffel Tower and you can recognize it on the image. But if you have the image of Eiffel Tower and some person on that, then you probably know that these are two different stuffs. So the people on the image and the Eiffel Tower, and you should not ever connect them. One funny thing, Google Neural Network, when was asked to show an image of dumbbell, you know, just for exercising, it always show the image of not the dumbbell itself, but always with an arm, always. So it associated one with another. And if I can tell if it works as a human brain, well, it depends on the cases.
Yeah, but it's comparing neural networks to human brain has like many levels. What you said before was about not about learning algorithms, because basically deep neural networks, linear neural networks use backpropagation algorithm, and neurons in the brain use, even if we consider them if we model them with mathematical neurons, computational neuroscientists discovered that our brains use different learning algorithms.
It also depends.
Don't use backpropagation, and basically the brain isn't like a linear network. There are some recurrent neural networks, but.
I can of course agree with you, but
I think the guy before me tried to say that neurons, mathematical neurons and backpropagation don't really have anything to do with human brains.
Well, I can compare it to motivation. So spiking neural network is like motivation for people. So here you have a resemblance to human brain. But of course, if we can talk about this offline.
Okay, we had a question here in the front.
I wanted to ask if you know something about classification algorithms, but not for 2D objects, but for example, 3D point clouds. Because as far as I know, image recognition, so 2D objects recognition is right now quite lively area of studies, but the most of data that we as humans or as living organisms get is we can suspect that it is modeled in 3D, because it's the reality we are living in, and
Okay, so I can tell you that you can consider, you mean the image from the LiDAR, the three-dimensional map of points. It can be also considered as an image, but it will be a panoramic image. You know, it can be flattened as one image, and the value of the pixel is just the depth of the object of that point. How far is it from you? So if you think about them in that way, that it's the same as simple images. You can you have some grayscale, let's say from 0 to 255, and depending on the distance from you, you can have the white, black, gray areas on that image and process them like a simple image.
Okay.
So the question, is it really that important to differentiate from a car's perspective, let's say between pedestrians and other cars? Isn't it enough to simply, you know, recognize something that we shouldn't hit?
Well, no, because you know that people behave in another way than cars, because car probably can take a step in any side. It can usually move forward and backward, usually forward. But the pedestrian can, for example, take an immediate turn and just cross your way. So it's good to know that this object is a pedestrian and you need to be more careful.
I'd like to go back to this example with this hopeless sign, if possible. Because you said you tried everything to classify this one, and the results were, well, not satisfactory. And I think we could just split this problem into smaller ones, because we already found that this is a sign, that this is round, and there is a border. So yes, out of this 50-something signs we know, we are left with four or five, and we can maybe make a prioritized list which one is the most probable that this is and which is not, and then act appropriately.
I thought about this exactly in the same way, so I could detect that it's a prohibition sign. It was quite easy, but it wasn't easy to tell which one, so I assumed that it's better to take the conception that it's that sign that prohibit the most things, so just do not enter, something like this, and implement it in this way. Yeah, but it's a good remark. You know, that's true, but there is something called crowd psychology, so you can usually just check what other cars are doing, and if they are still riding there, so probably you can you can assume that you misclassified that sign.
Unless all of them are autonomous.
Well, we will have to face that problems in future, but there is a prediction that since 2018, about 80-90% of the car will be autonomous. So we will see what happened then, of course, if we will live long enough.
Yeah, wouldn't it be easier to cars moving at traffic, for autonomous cars moving at traffic, if the other cars are also autonomous? Then you can
yes,
just have some guidelines that these cars shouldn't do something, and they all know.
It will be much easier because there is still in specification, but vehicle-to-vehicle communication. So each car will be obliged to communicate to another what he wants to do in a couple of seconds. So other cars will know it earlier. But if there are humans, such a cars cannot predict it.
Okay, so I'm especially curious about the moral implications you mentioned. And do you know of any already implemented dilemmas? For example, I've read that Google cars are trained to behave, let's say, behave more carefully around children, so they recognize children and they update the behavior accordingly. Do you know of any other interesting examples of
this? All my information comes from Google website, and if you check the information of on that website, Google publish monthly reports of the Google car just on this website. If the car has encountered any untypical situation, and I can remember one when the Google car just recognized the grandma on a wheelchair chasing the duck. Have you ever seen something like this on the road? And yes, it has implemented some logic, especially when the ball just appear on the road, just to be very careful, because there is a very high probability that the some children will come out from the playground and cross your road. But I don't know anything more, just as you said.
If I may have an additional comment to the question related with car-to-car communication. We had actually a 5G presentation here this morning. It might be worth checking out if you're interested. They also showed a demo of this car-to-car communication in exactly the problem that you mentioned. So, one more question.
Maybe I wasn't ready, so...
Okay. Thank you very much. But my hand is very short.
What are the state-of-the-art methods for the classification problem in autonomous car? I mean, what is better, deep learning methods or handcrafted with super vector machines, handcrafted features?
You mean what is the if we compare sub? Okay, it's for sure deep neural networks, because SVMs only solve the simple problems and like classification. But you can combine some of SVMs just to solve some more complex problems. So I can tell you that deep neural networks have greater influence on everything, because they recognize more complex problems. You cannot even, well, you can try to model them mathematically, but sometimes it's really impossible to tell you what exactly this network recognizes. The problems are really complex.
It's limited to the amount of data, you have to come to overfitting, and so on, and when you have handcrafted features, histogram,
or usually this is solved by a few neural networks. Each there you have at least 100 of neural networks. You know, Google has big cloud servers, so they can allow to have such many neural networks. And the problem is submitted to every of these network, and just look what every network has produced on the output and compare the results. So it allows you to. You don't have the problem with overfitting then, because if some networks were adjusted to such data, the others weren't. So that's how you can eliminate that problem.
You probably can do the same with SVM, do the hierarchy of classification.
Yes, you can.
So the same with social
Last but not least, Lukasz Ziobron.